All right, well, welcome to Henbant then. We're a little small permaculture farm between the mountains and the sea, and we're up in northwest Wales. We've been here for 9 years, and we're on a little bit of a mission to try and prove, really, that you can take a small farm on a mortgage, that by using permaculture and holistic decision making, you can make that small farm pay its way through producing real food, that you can build soil, build biodiversity, build social capital, and that you can enjoy it. So like I said, we've been here for 9 years. We spent the first, 4 years, the place was completely derelict when we came. And we spent the first few years just having babies and putting on roofs, and it took us a year to get an electric supply and all these kind of things. So there's a long bit of that. And then this last 4 years, we've really started to put the farm together a lot more. You can learn all the kind of permaculture and holistic design you want, but actually there's those little, farmer's child secrets that they only get passed on that way. How do you actually put in a fence post square and easily, and how do you do all these things that you don't learn through that side of it? And so it's having people here for that protracted period where we can try and pass on at least what I've learned. And actually for the first 4 years here, we actually employed a local farmer's son, right, and we stole so many of the local secrets. Hi Jen. So I just brought you up here. This is the garden we first started with. So when we came, we had this permaculture, let's work out from zone one kind of philosophy. And we started at the house, and then we kind of put a little bit of stuff in the front garden. Then we started this kitchen garden, which is really close to the house. It's too small to be the market garden. And so now we use it slightly for experiments and little things like that. But also actually we mainly use it because one of our enterprises is tourism, and people come to the farm. And I think it's so important. Actually, one of the most important things we do is that people can come to the farm and they come down, they can pick some veg and they can grab a bottle of milk from the cow that's just been milked. And it's a bit like living in that Enid Blyton ransom kind of experience, this kind of little kind of small farm, whatever. So the idea is, anyway, if we're copying that savannah grassland system, is that we wanted to break the farm up into as much edge as possible. So kind of maximising that edge habitat through the whole farm. And also we want to keep those cows moving. And so these tree lanes are essentially, they're our wolves. So they enable us to keep the cows moving through this system every day. And if you think about it, everything we do on the farm has got to be super efficient. We're kind of trying to make sure that all the enterprises pay a wage, and if they're going to do that, then actually, because we're small, the cows don't buy me 20 minutes a day to move cows. They buy me 5 minutes a day to move cows. That's fine. And so actually it needs to be really tight on efficiency. And so actually by putting in these fence rows, all we have to do every day is just open a gate, cows go into the next field, and we close it again. Whereas if I was messing around with bigger, more complex fencing, which would work with a bigger herd, then it wouldn't work at our scale. But then breaking up those fields into those day-sized grazing units gives me this great opportunity to bring all this edge habitat in and bring in this kind of, these agroforestry lanes. And so that's what we've done. So we've broken up all our main grazing into 30 individual day-sized grazing units. And that's working beautifully. It's really helping us build soil, our sward density, our sward diversity. It's just gone crazy, actually, since we started doing it. It's been really effective. And so this is our kind of herd that's following the cattle around the system. So we've got 300 hens, and they move every other day onto fresh pasture, so they're never sat in their own manure, they're never kind of scratting away on bare earth, and they're really building soil as well, actually. So a bigger part of their diet comes from frogs and insects and herbs and seeds. So I just brought us up here. So this is what I think of as kind of wood pasture. So actually I think on this basis, if you went back 1,000 years, I don't think actually the whole system was just covered in giant oak trees. I think it was this kind of loose, kind of scrubby habitat. And so I think this is our Welsh savannah, really. And actually, this bit we stood in is quite dense. But really, with kind of 20-30% canopy cover, this kind of habitat, with these kind of like loose trees around it, and then with some structure around it to maintain that kind of constantly moving grazing, is what actually I'm kind of aiming for across a lot of the farm, actually. So the cows come through this system as well as part of that rotation, and then in winter we'll break out into the rest of the system. So when we bring people in, that kind of farm design process we go with people is basically going like, what's your context for your life? So what's that holistic context that you've got? And I think this is something permaculture needs more of, really, is this kind of like hard context building. And then you know why you're designing for whatever you're designing for that context. And then we go through looking at a farm using like Yeoman's scale of permanence, like Alfred Yeoman's scale of permanence for designing the whole farm landscape. And then we go over those individual enterprises. And with that, there's a lot of looking at nature to go, all right, how does a pig live in nature? All right, let's bring what we can and fit that within the farm space. Whatever it is, you can bring that into that. And then we've got lots of like that enterprise analysis and kind of recording stuff and looking at numbers and the kind of business side of it as well. Yeah. I think what's important actually is I was talking about the idea of bringing people onto the farm to experience nature. Like some of those people, they're just never going to camp, you know? And yeah. Some people are never going to stay in a camper shirt because they're going to think it's really cold at night. But actually, by the time you've got straw bale and a warm shower, it's always a matter of just slightly pushing people's comfort zone, but never breaking it. Just put whoever they are. So I need something for those people who come who have got a smaller comfort zone to still be happy when they're here. So what we've done is we're breaking the whole area down into 23-meter wide, like tree lanes. So every 23 meters on contour, kind of following that kind of like Yeoman's like key line design, we're breaking the whole system up into these nut-based tree rows. But before we do that, to help us clear the land, we're bringing in this little kind of forest team, really. And so there's five of these somewhere. And hello, girls. And hello. They're super friendly, actually. So they come through and they're just disturbing that soil and kind of breaking open that seed bank, which actually, and it's quite interesting, you can look at the ground before they go into a space, and then the ground once it's had a little bit of time to recover, and actually it is diverser where they've been. And we do have a kind of big kind of a permaculture based design for the whole system, and we tend to have like a big, I'm really cautious of having that kind of like that kind of base map, this is what we're doing, mm-hmm. thing, especially something the size of Hembant, because actually things are always changing and evolving. And also sometimes a system, it's really good for this at some point, mm-hmm. but actually 10 years down the line, the whole system's changed. And it's then got a different function, a different space. And so it's kind of working with that. It's like you can draw your base map and go, this is this, this is this, this is this. Mm-hmm. Actually, 10 years later, this has turned to that. And this has to, you know, this, and it, or the whole thing's changing. So. Yeah, it's not static, but there is a kind of bigger design. Yeah, these are our permaculture ducks in the garden thing. Do you know what? They're grazing around. And do you know what? At first I thought it was a bit of a gimmick, this whole like ducks eating slugs in the garden. And then I was a bit like, oh no, they're just going to eat all the seedlings. But actually it works. They do take a lot of slugs out. And actually, once the plants are even a little bit established, there's so many green things in here that, you know, they don't actually take all the little seedlings out. No, it's working really well. So this is No Dig Market Garden. And so we kind of came from this, you know, this kind of bigger holistic context, this big kind of permaculture side of it. So, you know, like one of the most destructive things that humans do is cultivation. And so we wanted to avoid losing topsoil, wanted to build soil. So we don't do any cultivation, actually. And it's all no dig. So it's based on putting compost, compost onto the beds with wood chip paths. And this is a really kind of particular part of our system. I guess it comes from Richard Perkins, really. But these kind of wood chip paths. So that enables us to build a much healthier like soil food web, because instantly we've got this kind of, we can support a more mycorrhizal based soil food web. It means that the paths aren't a waste of space. The paths are feeding right underneath the beds as well. It means it's really easy to keep quite weed free, because actually the wood chip's really loose, so we can easily pull out any weeds in it. But then the most functional part of the garden really is this idea that it kind of, I don't know if it goes against permaculture or not, but it's really regularized. So actually we've got 120 just identical beds. They're 75 centimeters wide, they're 10 meters long. And that pattern repeats itself right through, so that we can have a really tight cropping program. So we can go, right, you know, bed north 36 can swap out with bed south 24. And so actually all these beds will do probably three crops in a season, maybe two, but probably three and sometimes four crops over that season. And it enables us to have a really efficient market garden, because it's really easy to manage, it's really well planned. But this bit here, I'm going to make into a classroom. Mm-hmm. So this will be a classroom, and then we'll feed people. If it rains, the barn will be nice enough, we can feed people in there. But really, we'll eat in the garden. And do these like feasts in the garden. Mm-hmm. So just a space to cook to support courses. Mm-hmm. Cook to support. We have a lot of people come through to see that, to whatever. We have a lot of visitors. Yeah. And actually, Henbant's almost capable of providing not a whole diet, but really going in that direction. Actually, by the time we do meat, dairy, mm-hmm. vegetables,
eggs,
actually, you've got a big part of people part of diet. And what's exciting actually is off this tiny area. Like, we're only really using 20 acres of the farm hard. Mm-hmm. We can produce, like, nearly a significant part of the diet for 60 families off a tiny space, actually. And I kind of figure if we can do that, then, I don't know, you can kind of save the world. And I'm not even a farmer. So if I can do that, then actually the potential is huge, isn't it?